define mechanisms of transcription regulation about initiation, elongation, termination, splicing, post-transcriptional modifications. Surprisingly, very little is known about spatial arrangement of transcription in the nucleus. So we know that actually what happens with a gene when it's expressed. We know that expressed genes sit somewhere in the nuclear interior, in euchromatin. And this is practically all that we know about spatial organization. The mostly developed and popular idea about spatial organization of transcription is idea about transcription factories. According to this hypothesis, polymerases are immobilized in groups and express genes approaching polymerases and are reeled through them with nascent RNA transcripts extruded in a spot. It's a very elegant and attractive hypothesis. But is it really what happens with expressed genes? In my talk today, I am going to argue that there are no transcription factories, but expressed genes form transcription loops with polymerases moving along the loops and carrying nascent RNA transcripts. The problem with genes in the context of a nucleus is apparently the limitation of microscopy resolution. If you think about a gene 10 kilobase long, when completely stretched, the gene measures only half a micron. But genes are never stretched in the nuclei. Chromatin is coiled. Therefore, instead of zooming into the small genes, we reversed our approach and we searched for highly expressed long genes, about or longer 100 kilobases. To cut this long story about long genes short, we found that there are not many such genes. What is more, long genes are practically never highly expressed in undifferentiated or weakly differentiated cells, meaning cultured cells. Therefore, we had to focus on differentiated cells in the context of tissues. Oops. So we selected a gene, highly upregulated gene, which is expressed in thyroid gland, thyroglobulin. The gene is about 180 kilobase long, and it's expressed higher than 20,000 transcripts per million, much higher than housekeeping genes, such as ribosomal genes or actin. Okay, so we prepared cryosections of a mouse thyroid gland. We use genomic probe for the gene. We performed RNA FISH, and this is what we saw. Well, in the beginning, we even couldn't understand what we are looking at. And then we realized that the thyroglobulin gene forms these gigantic loops protruding into the nuclear interior. And the length of these loops is just remarkable. This is up to 10 microns. Or rather, this is underestimation because it's measured on projections. So what are these structures? We're convinced that these structures are made by extremely decondensed thyroglobulin gene with polymerases moving along the gene and carrying nascent RNA transcripts. So in the next five slides, I am going to convince you too with the five following arguments. First, we see the loops because they're heavily decorated by thousands and thousands nascent RNA transcripts, which we detect by RNA FISH. This is why in neighboring cells not expressing thyroglobulin, there is no fish signal. Secondly, when we perform DNA fish, we can hardly trace the structure of the loop because the gene is very decondensed. In those cells which do not express thyroglobulin, the gene is highly condensed and sequestered to the nuclear periphery, as it should be. Thirdly, we can detect progression of the transcription along the loop. The probes for 5' intron of this gene label the entire loop. This is a green color. The probes for the second half 3' intron exons label only half of the loop, as one would expect. Alternatively, the probe which highlight 5' and 3' intron should label this transcription loop sequentially as a result of co-transcriptional splicing. And this is the case. The first half of the loop is green because it's labeled by yet unspliced green introns. The second half of the loop is red because it's labeled by yet unspliced 3' introns. Of course, 5' and 3' exons also contribute to the loop labeling, but just a little bit. And finally, our loops are so huge, they have to be excluded from harboring chromosome. And they are. So here you can see chromosome 15 harboring thyroglobulin gene in green and transcription loop in red. And you can see that thyroglobulin transcription loop forms its own transcription territory next to chromosome territory. Hi-C analysis of thyrocytes also show that the gene falls out of the context of a chromosome because it has an abnormally low ratio of cis to trans frequency contact frequencies in comparison to other long but lowly expressed genes, or in comparison to thyroglobulin in those cells, control cells, which do not express the gene. With these five arguments, I hope I convinced you that the structures we are looking at are transcription loops with ongoing transcription of thyroglobulin gene. And as a matter of fact, we were extremely lucky to hit exactly this gene because it's remarkably highly upregulated. And interestingly enough, not only in mammals, but actually in all classes of vertebrates. So we see thyroglobulin transcription loops in mouse, also in human, by the way, in birds, in amphibia, and also in fish. And this brings me to a question whether transcription loop formation is a unique feature of thyroglobulin gene. Okay, if I pose this question, you should probably guess that the answer is no. So all in all, we studied more than 50 mouse genes. And we found several other genes which form transcription loops. Importantly, we learned that this is a combination of both gene length and expression level, which is needed for formation of a transcription loop. Highly expressed genes, but short, do not form microscopically resolvable loop, like actin. Long genes, but lowly expressed, also do not. As you see, this is the longest gene in the human or mouse genome, dystrophin. So genes have to be reasonably long and reasonably highly expressed to be resolved, like titin in skeletal muscles or myosin in smooth muscles. Well, why expression level is so important for transcription loop formation? We have a hypothesis about it. When we think about highly expressed gene, we all have this image in our heads, the famous Christmas tree with RNA, nascent RNA transcripts oriented perpendicularly to the gene axis. But this image is deceptive. We all know that every nascent RNA transcript binds hundreds and hundreds of proteins involved in RNA processing, quality control, transport, even translation. The proteins are already there. Therefore, these proteins, together with nascent RNA transcript, are wrapped in RNP granules. And in case of a long nascent RNA, such RNP granules are larger than nucleosomes or even polymerase complexes, meaning that highly expressed gene is heavily decorated by progressively growing in size RNP granules. And this makes the gene axis less flexible, rigid, stiff. And this stiffness actually, in turn, forces the gene to loop out of chromosome territory into the nuclear space. Do we have evidence supporting this hypothesis? I am convinced we do. So there are four lines of evidence supporting this. First of all, transcription loops, as you would expect from a rigid loop, have their flanks separated. In 70% of thyroglobulin alleles, the 5' and 3' flanks are microscopically separated with a distance larger, two times larger than in control cells do not express in the gene. Moreover, thyroglobulin genes are so loops are so stiff that they can break harboring chromosome territory in two parts. In approximately 10% of alleles, we clearly see the gap between two halves of chromosome territories. We see flank separation in all studied transcription loops, which is actually a very surprising finding, because we know that in a highly expressed genes, promoter is supposed to be associated with the 3' end of the gene to enable polymerase circulation. Apparently, this is not the case with our genes, at least. Secondly, two halves of thyroglobulin gene, when it forms a loop, are differently extended, reflecting different stiffness of these two halves. The first half of the gene, which is decorated by short nascent RNA transcripts, is coiled much stronger than the second half of the gene, which is decorated by longer nascent RNA transcripts. And since the second half of the gene includes this long intron of 54 kilobases, over which nascent RNA grow from 7 kilobases to 60 kilobases, we wanted to check whether this extension of the second half of the gene is because of this intron. And indeed, the intron signal is very much extended and contributes almost to the half of the entire transcription loop signal. But what is really very, very exciting that we actually can see this RNP granules under electron microscope. So we see massive accumulations of granules in thyrocytes nuclei. Actually, these structures, to my knowledge, haven't been described for mammalian nuclei before ever. So here I highlight them for you with the red granules, but now I zoom in. So you see these accumulations better. and zoom in even more, so you can appreciate that this granules, this is a little bit too light for the pictures, but you can see that these granules are homogeneously structured and have diameter of 20 nanometers. In this respect, the other gene, which forms transcription loops, titin gene, is even more interesting because titin's mRNA is about 100 kilobases, meaning that this RN piece should be bigger and accumulation should be seen better. And this is the case. Even on small magnification of this huge myotube nuclei, you see fields which are filled by these granules of 30 nanometers diameter. And from time to time, we see even accumulations of granules of a different size, obviously. I guess this is a growing RNP particles up to 50 nanometers. Well, do we have an evidence that these RNP accumulations, these granule accumulations, correspond to our transcription loops? For this, we performed correlative microscopy, and we collected two consecutive thin sections, only thin sections, one on a grid for electron microscopy, one on a slide for RNA fish, and by this way, we could reliably identify the same nuclei on both sections. And correspondingly, of course, we could correlate RNA fish signals with granular accumulations. And correlation is surprisingly very good, more than 50%. Right, so can we, is there any way to prove the stiffness of transcription loops experimentally? It seems like direct biological experiments are not feasible so far. Therefore, we did what actually biologists do when they don't know what to do. We modeled the loop. And this is a collaborative work with Johannes Neubler and Leonid Mirny from MIT. Johannes modeled loops as 50 MB polymers, and he assigned to each polymer 100 kilobase region as a gene of interest. And then changes properties of the genes, we explored at which conditions we can recapitulate biological observables. So for instance, a mere increase the gene contour length as a result of partial nucleosome lost during transcription did not lead to formation of loops, and interflank distances were also very small, and cis-trans ratio did not change. Only models with increased stiffness could recapitulate the loop formation, the distance between flanks, and the deepened cis-trans ratio. And when we changed the stiffness gradually from 5' prime end to 3' prime end, as you would expect, of course, for a normal gene, these models performed even better because they could recapitulate even the asymmetry in this curve for ratio cis-trans with a more steep part at the 3' prime end, exactly as we observe for three cell types in the real high C data for three cell types. Well, so what I showed you argued that indeed transcription loops are stiff structures, and they are stiff because they are decorated by nascent RNA, by nascent RNP particles, which are progressively growing in size over long introns or toward the 3' end of the gene. This also explains why we do not see transcription loops of small genes, because they don't have long introns, first of all. Second, RNA built on these small genes are short. Therefore, RNP particles are small, and when they decorate the gene axis, it doesn't prevent gene from coiling. So the gene coils, and we see it as a just a small focus as a dot. Well, coming back to our initial question, what is the special arrangement of transcription? We believe this every transcribed gene forms a transcription loop, and transcription loop formation is a universal principle of eukaryotic transcription. Well, I have not prepared a summary slide for my talk today. So instead, I would like to show you a small animation which reflects our vision of eukaryotic transcription. So in this small animation, you will see two transcription bursts. So you see how polymerases are loading to the promoter. They start to elongate. Immediately, the RNP particles are growing. This is the end of the first burst, and immediately chromatin coils behind in the wake of the last polymerase. Now, RNP particles are growing, the loop becomes stiff, and the flanks start to separate. This is the second transcription burst. You see the sliding knot. The chromatin is constantly coiling beyond the last polymerase and eaten by the first polymerase of the second burst. Okay, mRNA leaving the gene. This is the end of transcription. Chromatin starts to coil at the 5' prime end into the flank. The loop shrinks, and flanks are converging. And so that's kind of summarizes the whole story. Right, so this is initial state. Actually, we could observe this in some experiments, which I didn't have time to show today. Okay, there is a team of people working on this project. And first of all, I would like to mention Susanna Leidesche. She's a PhD student, and she's a master of myotube differentiation, transcription loop initiation, inhibition, RNA-seq, ChIP-seq, and all these wonderful experiments which I could not show today. Yana Fyodorova, who's in the audience. Yana performed high-C experiments and also some initial fish experiments for this project. And finally, Johannes Neubler, who analyzed high-C data and he modeled the loop. With this, I would like to finish and would be happy to answer your questions.
So, questions for...
Yes, Eretz.
Hey, that was a really loud... that was a really wonderful talk. I had a question, though, about the term loop that you're using. I mean, it's fine. It's totally amazing. But I wonder why you call it a loop, because it seems like one of your points is that actually the 5' prime and the 3' prime ends are a little bit far apart. They're not at the same place. So it seems like, I don't know, extended or decondensed chromatin interval would make more sense or something like that.
Yes, Eretz, I knew you will ask something like this. Yeah. So this is not the loop which is formed by extrusion or something. Yes. But I looked in the dictionary very carefully, and I can call this structure loop. We call it open loop.
Wonderful.
Sorry, I forgot to mention about it.
Good. Beautiful work.
Can I go ahead, Eris? Is that it?
Beautiful work. Thank you for your talk. I was wondering, in your beautiful EM images, how do you achieve this RNP granule specific contrast?
Oh, it's not RNP specific for sure.
I see.
No, we just unfortunately we cannot use the high super high resolution microscopy because it's for correlative microscopy. So we have to use not the most hardest resins. We use Lobicryl, which is not the best for resolution, but this is the best what we can achieve, and this is uranyl acetate contrasting. I don't think that the lead adds much to this. Yeah.
Thanks.
So when you show the granules, what do you think the granules, they look very uniform, and that's, you know, they could have different amounts of RNA in them and condensed, particularly as introns. So what do you think the granule is that you're showing in your staining of a section of the nucleus?
So can I maybe rephrase your questions? Are you asking about whether one granule, this one granular, is one nascent RNA transcript? That's what you ask.
They're very uniform.
Yes.
And they could be an RNA transcript, they could be an intron or before it's excised, it could be a polymerase, I don't know. What do you think that granule is?
I think this is RNP particles. And actually, when I showed first these granules in thyrocytes, I think my feeling is, we have not proven it, actually we're working on it, that these granules are really just this huge intron number 41, which has more than 50 kilobases. Because other parts of the thyroglobulin, they are unspectacular, so they're always constantly excised introns. So the mRNA is about 7 kb only, or 8 kb only, so it's very small.
Okay.
But I just wanted to add that we indeed don't know whether one granular is one nascent RNA transcript. Maybe it's two or three granules because they are huge. It's 100 kb mRNA, so we don't know. I also would like to pay call your attention that these granules are very densely packed. I didn't want to mention this phase separation, but today, but I think there is something about it.
Okay, it's an absolutely beautiful talk. I really like the data, the cryo-EM data, but then I got a little bit nervous with your movie at the end. Mm-hmm. And your movie at the end, is that what you really believe or that's a suggestion? Also, you show a lot of spatial information, but I didn't see a time coordinate on the movie. So do you want to comment on both? It's basically, it appears to be consistent with the data, but should we believe or that's sort of a guidance for us to speculate about it?
Yeah, this is a pure, of course, speculation. It's very primitive movie as well. As you noticed, there is no splicing at all. Yeah, and we don't know about the speed. And I did not touch the question about the transcription bursts, which are a very important point in transcription. There are many points just skipped, but you know what? This animation is very costly. So I haven't done it myself yet. So. And otherwise, it would be not 1 minute, but 2 minutes. And then.
And what's the time in real time, basically, if you put real time in biology? How do?
Okay, we can only speculate because I take the transcription rate 3.8 kb per minute. And in this case, thyroglobulin gene needs about 1 hour. And titin gene, which is 280 kilobases, required 1.5 hours. And we have a very good correlation with this when we use DRB inhibition of transcription and then release of transcription. We see them very close. Maybe we want to see that one.
Okay, one last question.
Thank you so much. It's a beautiful model you have there. My question is, you talked about this as a universal model for how transcription looks in the cell, right? This open loop formation. And my understanding of what you're proposing is that the increased stiffness is what's doing this. And do you think there's going to be some threshold where, like, it's only at some level of expression? Like, what do you think is controlling? Like, is there going to be some cutoff, like, below some certain stiffness? Like, some certain expression level, you're going to get this loop formation, and above it, below it, there's none, and above it, there is? Or is it just a smooth transition, like, the stiffness is increasing smoothly? Can you measure that from your experimental data?
No. The answer is no, but yeah. It's also, I understand some reservation of people when they talk about, why do you call it loops? Yeah, okay, because they look like a loop for a couple of genes. For for titin, for instance, this loop is never very clear, and I know why, because it's expressed in a short pulses and has a long pauses. I couldn't show this data, yeah. Yeah, but the experimental, as I said, the experimental proof of a stiffness, we don't know, only indirect indications. Yes, yes.
Well, let's thank Karine again. the computers.